First intention is for the long life, and we all make dua, and Haryamar is going to read the dua for us. The second intention of the Yasin is for the dafa-i balaya, the calamities to go away. And the third one is for the risk, so prosperity and the kushadai risk. So these three intentions, one is for the long life, second is for the calamities to go move away, and the third one is the prosperity for the risk, inshallah. And the dua will be there with inshallah we'll start. Bismillah Sayyidi.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ياسين والقرآن الحكيم. إنك لمن المرسلين على صراط مستقيم. تنزيل العزيز الرحيم. لتنذر قوما ما أنذر آباؤهم فهم غافلون. لقد حق القول على أكثرهم فهم لا يؤمنون. إنا جعلنا في أعناقهم أغلالا فهي إلى الأذقان فهم مقمحون. وجعلنا من بين أيديهم سدا ومن خلفهم سدا فأغشيناهم فهم لا يبصرون. وسواء عليهم أأنذرتهم أم لم تنذرهم لا يؤمنون. إنما تنذر من اتبع الذكر وخشي الرحمن بالغيب فبشره بمغفرة وأجر كريم. إنا نحن نحيي الموتى ونكتب ما قدموا وآثارهم وكل شيء أحصيناه في إمام مبين. واضرب لهم مثلا أصحاب القرية إذ جاء المرسلون. إذ أرسلنا إليهم اثنين فكذبوهما فعززنا بثالث فقالوا إنا إليكم مرسلون. قالوا ما أنتم إلا بشر مثلنا وما أنزل الرحمن من شيء إن أنتم إلا تكذبون. قالوا ربنا يعلم إنا إليكم لمرسلون وما علينا إلا البلاغ المبين. قالوا إنا تطيرنا بكم لئن لم تنتهوا لنرجمنكم وليمسنكم منا عذاب أليم. قالوا طائركم معكم أئن ذكرتم بل أنتم قوم مسرفون. وجاء من أقصى المدينة رجل يسعى قال يا قوم اتبعوا المرسلين. اتبعوا من لا يسألكم أجرا وهم مهتدون وما لي لا أعبد الذي فطرني وإليه ترجعون أأتخذ من دونه آلهة إن يردني الرحمن بضر لا تغن عني شفاعتهم شيئا ولا ينقذون إني إذا لفي ضلال مبين إني آمنت بربكم فاسمعون قيل ادخل الجنة قال يا ليت قومي يعلمون بما غفر لي ربي وجعلني من المكرمين وما أنزلنا على قومه من بعده من جند من السماء وما كنا منزلين إن كانت إلا صيحة واحدة فإذا هم خامدون يا حسرة على العباد ما يأتيهم من رسول إلا كانوا به يستهزئون ألم يروا كم أهلكنا قبلهم من القرون أنهم إليهم لا يرجعون كل لما جميع لدينا محضرون وآية لهم الأرض الميتة أحييناها وأخرجنا منها حبا فمنه يأكلون وجعلنا فيها جنات من نخيل وأعناب وفجرنا فيها من العيون ليأكلوا من ثمره وما عملته أيديهم أفلا يشكرون سبحان الذي خلق الأزواج كلها مما تنبت الأرض ومن أنفسهم ومما لا يعلمون وآية لهم الليل نسلخ منه النهار فإذا هم مظلمون والشمس تجري لمستقر لها ذلك تقدير العزيز العليم والقمر قدرناه منازل حتى عاد كالعرجون القديم لا الشمس ينبغي لها أن تدرك القمر ولا الليل سابق النهار وكل في فلك يسبحون وآية لهم أنا حملنا ذريتهم في الفلك المشحون وخلقنا لهم من مثله ما يركبون وإن نشأ نغرقهم فلا صريخ لهم ولا هم ينقذون إلا رحمة منا ومتاعا إلى حين وإذا قيل لهم اتقوا ما بين أيديكم وما خلفكم لعلكم ترحمون وما تأتيهم من آية من آيات ربهم إلا كانوا عنها معرضين لَهُمْ أَنفِقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقَكُمُ اللَّهُ قَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَنُطْعِمُ مَن لَّوْ يَشَاءُ اللَّهُ أَطْعَمَهُ إن أنتم إلا في ضلال مبين ويقولون متى هذا الوعد إن كنتم صادقين ما ينظرون إلا صيحة واحدة تأخذهم وهم يخصمون فلا يستطيعون توصية ولا إلى أهلهم يرجعون ونفخ في الصور فإذا هم من الأجداث إلى ربهم ينسلون قالوا يا ويلنا من بعثنا من مرقدنا هذا ما وعد الرحمن وصدق المرسلون إن كانت إلا صيحة واحدة فإذا هم جميع لدينا محضرون فاليوم لا تظلم نفس شيئا ولا تجزون إلا ما كنتم تعملون أصحاب الجنة اليوم في شغل فاكهون هم وأزواجهم في ظلال على الأرائك متكئون لهم فيها فاكهة ولهم ما يدعون سلام قولا من رب رحيم وامتاز اليوم أيها المجرمون ألم أعهد إليكم يا بني آدم ألا تعبدوا الشيطان إنه لكم عدو مبين وأن اعبدوني هذا صراط مستقيم ولقد أضل منكم جبلا كثيرا أفلم تكونوا تعقلون هذه جهنم التي كنتم توعدون اليوم بما كنتم تكفرون اليوم نختم على أفواههم وتكلمنا أيديهم وتشهد أرجلهم بما كانوا يكسبون ولو نشاء لطمسنا على أعينهم فاستبقوا الصراط فأنى يبصرون ولو نشاء لمسخناهم على مكانتهم فما استطاعوا مضيا ولا يرجعون ومن نعمره ننكسه في الخلق أفلا يعقلون وما علمناه الشعر وما ينبغي له إن هو إلا ذكر وقرآن مبين لينذر من كان حيا ويحق القول على الكافرين أولم يروا أنا خلقنا لهم مما عملت أيدينا أنعاما فهم لها مالكون ناها لهم فمنها ركوبهم ومنها يأكلون ولهم فيها منافع ومشارب أفلا يشكرون واتخذوا من دون الله آلهة لعلهم ينصرون لا يستطيعون نصرهم وهم لهم جند محضرون فلا يحزنك قولهم إنا نعلم ما يسرون وما يعلنون أولم ير الإنسان أنا خلقناه من نطفة فإذا هو خصيم مبين وضرب لنا مثلا ونسي خلقه قال من يحيي العظام وهي رميم قل يحييها الذي أنشأها أول مرة وهو بكل خلق عليم الذي جعل لكم من الشجر الأخضر نارا فإذا أنتم منه توقدون أوليس الذي خلق السماوات والأرض بقادر على أن يخلق مثلهم بلى وهو الخلاق العليم إنما أمره إذا أراد شيئا أن يقول له كن فيكون فسبحان الذي بيده ملكوت كل شيء وإليه ترجعون دعاء إن شاء الله. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اللهم يا ذا المن ولا يمن عليه، يا ذا الجلال والإكرام، يا ذا الطول والإنعام، لا إله إلا أنت ظهر اللاجئين وجار المستجيرين وأمان الخائفين. اللهم إن كنت كتبتنا عندك في أم الكتاب أشقياء أو محرومين أو مطرودين أو مفترا علي أو مقترا علينا في الرزق، فامحو اللهم بفضلك شقاوتنا وحرماننا وطردنا واختيار رزقنا وأثبتنا عندك في أم الكتاب سعداء مرزوقين موفقا للخيرات. فإنك قلت وقولك الحق في كتابك المنزل على لسان نبيك المرسل، يمحو الله ما يشاء ويثبت وعنده أم الكتاب. إلهي بالتجلي الأعظم في ليلة النصف من شهر شعبان المكرم التي يفرق فيها كل أمر حكيم ويبرم، أن تكشف عنا من البلاء والبلواء ما نعلم وما لا نعلم وأنت به أعلم إنك أنت الأعز الأكرم. وصلى الله تعالى على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم، والحمد لله رب العالمين. ساكن ياسين إن شاء الله. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ياسين والقرآن الحكيم. إنك لمن المرسلين على صراط مستقيم، تنزيل العزيز الرحيم، لتنذر قوما ما أنذر آباؤهم فهم غافلون، لقد حق القول على أكثرهم فهم لا يؤمنون، إنا جعلنا في أعناقهم أغلالا فهي إلى الأذقان فهم مقمحون، وجعلنا من بين أيديهم سدا ومن خلفهم سدا فأغشيناهم فهم لا يبصرون، وسواء عليهم أنذرتهم أم لم تنذرهم لا يؤمنون، إنما تنذر من اتبع الذكر وخشي الرحمن بالغيب فبشره بمغفرة وأجر كريم. إنا نحن نحيي الموتى ونكتب ما قدموا وآثارهم وكل شيء أحصيناه في إمام مبين. واضرب لهم مثلا أصحاب القرية إذ جاءها المرسلون. إذ أرسلنا إليهم اثنين فكذبوهما فعززنا بثالث فقالوا إنا إليكم مرسلون. قالوا ما أنتم إلا بشر مثلنا وما أنزل الرحمن من شيء إن أنتم إلا تكذبون. قالوا ربنا يعلم إنا إليكم لمرسلون وما علينا إلا البلاغ المبين. قالوا إنا تطيرنا بكم لئن لم تنتهوا لنرجمنكم وليمسنكم منا عذاب أليم. قالوا طائركم معكم أئن ذكرتم بل أنتم قوم مسرفون. وجاء من أقصى المدينة رجل يسعى قال يا قوم اتبعوا المرسلين. اتبعوا من لا يسألكم أجرا وهم مهتدون. وما لي لا أعبد الذي فطرني وإليه ترجعون. أأتخذ من دونه آلهة إن يردني الرحمن بضر لا تغن عني شفاعتهم شيئا ولا ينقذون. إني إذا لفي ضلال مبين. إني آمنت بربكم فاسمعون. قيل ادخل الجنة قال يا ليت قومي يعلمون. بما غفر لي ربي وجعلني من المكرمين. وما أنزلنا على قومه من بعده من جند من السماء وما كنا منزلين. إن كانت إلا صيحة واحدة فإذا هم خامدون. يا حسرة على العباد ما يأتيهم من رسول إلا كانوا به يستهزئون. ألم يروا كم أهلكنا قبلهم من القرون أنهم إليهم لا يرجعون. وإن كل لما جميع لدينا محضرون. آية لهم الأرض الميتة أحييناها وأخرجنا منها حبا فمنه يأكلون. وجعلنا فيها جنات من نخيل وأعناب وفجرنا فيها من العيون ليأكلوا من ثمره وما عملت أيديهم أفلا يشكرون. سبحان الذي خلق الأزواج كلها مما تنبت الأرض ومن أنفسهم ومما لا يعلمون. وآية لهم الليل نسلخ منه النهار فإذا هم مظلمون. والشمس تجري لمستقر لها ذلك تقدير العزيز العليم. والقمر قدرناه منازل حتى عاد كالعرجون القديم. لا الشمس ينبغي لها أن تدرك القمر ولا الليل سابق النهار وكل في فلك يسبحون. وآية لهم أنا وحملنا ذريتهم في الفلك المشحون وخلقنا لهم من مثله ما يركبون وإن نشأ نغرقهم فلا صريخ لهم ولا هم ينقذون إلا رحمة منا ومتاعا إلى حين وإذا قيل لهم اتقوا ما بين أيديكم وما خلفكم لعلكم ترحمون وما تأتيهم من آية من آيات ربهم إلا كانوا عنها معرضين وإذا قيل لهم أنفقوا مما رزقكم الله قال الذين كفروا للذين آمنوا أنطعم من لو يشاء الله أطعمه إن أنتم إلا في ضلال مبين ويقولون متى هذا الوعد إن كنتم صادقين ما ينظرون إلا صيحة واحدة تأخذهم وهم يخصمون فلا يستطيعون توصية ولا إلى أهلهم لعلهم يرجعون ونفخ في الصور فإذا هم من الأجداث إلى ربهم ينسلون قالوا يا ويلنا من بعثنا من مرقدنا هذا ما وعد الرحمن وصدق المرسلون إن كانت إلا صيحة واحدة فإذا هم جميع لدينا محضرون فاليوم لا تظلم نفس شيئا ولا تجزون إلا ما كنتم تعملون إن أصحاب الجنة اليوم في شغل فاكهون هم وأزواجهم في ظلال على الأرائك متكئون لهم فيها فاكهة ولهم ما يدعون سلام قولا من رب رحيم وامتاز اليوم أيها المجرمون هد إليكم يا بني آدم ألا تعبدوا الشيطان إنه لكم عدو مبين وأن اعبدوني هذا صراط مستقيم ولقد أضل منكم جبلا كثيرا أفلم تكونوا تعقلون هذه جهنم التي كنتم توعدون اصلوها اليوم بما كنتم تكفرون اليوم نختم على أفواههم وتكلمنا أيديهم وتشهد أرجلهم بما كانوا يكسبون ولو نشاء لطمسنا على أعينهم فاستبقوا الصراط فأنى يبصرون ولو نشاء لمسخناهم على مكانتهم فما استطاعوا مضيا ولا يرجعون ومن نعمره ننكسه في الخلق أفلا يعقلون وما علمناه الشعر وما ينبغي له إن هو إلا ذكر وقرآن مبين لينذر من كان حيا ويحق القول على الكافرين أولم يروا أنا خلقنا لهم مما عملت أيدينا أنعاما فهم لها مالكون وذللناها لهم فمنها ركوبهم ومنها يأكلون ولهم فيها منافع ومشارب أفلا يشكرون واتخذوا من دون الله آلهة لعلهم ينصرون لا يستطيعون نصرهم وهم لهم جند محضرون فلا يحزنك قولهم إنا نعلم ما يسرون وما يعلنون أولم ير الإنسان أنا خلقناه من نطفة فإذا هو خصيم مبين وضرب لنا مثلا ونسي خلقه قال من يحيي العظام وهي رميم قل يحييها الذي أنشأها أول مرة وهو بكل خلق عليم الذي جعل لكم من الشجر الأخضر نارا فإذا أنتم منه توقدون الذي خلق السماوات والأرض بقادر على أن يخلق مثلهم بلى وهو الخلاق العليم إنما أمره إذا أراد شيئا أن يقول له كن فيكون فسبحان الذي بيده ملكوت كل شيء وإليه ترجعون بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اللهم يا ذا المن ولا يمن عليه يا ذا الجلال والإكرام يا ذا الطول والإنعام لا إله إلا أنت ظهر اللاجئين وجار المستجيرين وأمان الخائفين اللهم إن كنت كتبتنا عندك في أم الكتاب أشقياء أو محروم أو مطرودين أو مقترا علينا في الرزق فامحوا اللهم بفضلك شقاوتنا وحرماننا وطردنا واقتتار في رزقنا وأثبتنا عندك في أم الكتاب سعداء مرزوقين موفقين للخيرات فإنك قلت وقولك الحق في كتابك المنزل على لسان نبيك المرسل يمحو الله ما يشاء ويثبت وعنده أم الكتاب إلهنا بالتجلي الأعظم في ليلة النصف من شهر شعبان المكرم التي يفرق فيها كل أمر حكيم ويبرم أن تكشف عنا من البلاء والبلواء ما نعلم وما لا نعلم وأنت به أعلم إنك أنت الأعز الأكرم وصلى الله تعالى على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والحمد لله رب العالمين اللهم صل وسلم Inshallah, Yasin for third time. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ياسين والقرآن الحكيم إنك لمن المرسلين على صراط مستقيم تنزيل العزيز الرحيم لتنذر قوما ما أنذر آباؤهم فهم غافلون لقد حق القول على أكثرهم فهم لا يؤمنون إنا جعلنا في أعناقهم أغلالا فهي إلى الأذقان فهم مقمحون وجعلنا من بين بين أيديهم سدا ومن خلفهم سدا فأغشيناهم فهم لا يبصرون وسواء عليهم أأنذرتهم أم لم تنذرهم لا يؤمنون إنما تنذر من اتبع الذكر وخشي الرحمن بالغيب فبشره بمغفرة وأجر كريم إنا نحن نحيي الموتى ونكتب ما قدموا وآثارهم وكل شيء أحصيناه في إمام مبين واضرب لهم مثلا أصحاب القرية إذ جاء المرسلون إذ أرسلنا إليهم اثنين فكذبوهما فعززنا بثالث فقالوا إنا إليكم مرسلون قالوا ما أنتم إلا بشر مثلنا وما أنزل الرحمن من شيء إن أنتم إلا تكذبون قالوا ربنا يعلم إنا إليكم لمرسلون وما علينا إلا البلاغ المبين قالوا إنا تطيرنا بكم لئن لم تنتهوا لنرجمنكم وليمسنكم منا عذاب أليم قالوا طائركم معكم أئن ذكرتم بل أنتم قوم مسرفون وجاء من أقصى المدينة رجل يسعى قال يا قوم اتبعوا المرسلين اتبعوا من لا يسألكم أجرا وهم مهتدون وما لي لا أعبد الذي فطرني وإليه ترجعون أأتخذ من دونه آلهة إن يردني الرحمن بضر لا تغن عني شفاعتهم شيئا ولا ينقذون إني إذا لفي ضلال مبين إني آمنت بربكم فاسمعون قيل ادخل الجنة قال يا ليت قومي يعلمون بما غفر لي ربي وجعلني من المكرمين وما أنزلنا على قومه من بعده من جند من السماء وما كنا منزلين إن كانت إلا صيحة واحدة فإذا هم خامدون يا حسرة على العباد ما يأتيهم من رسول إلا كانوا به يستهزئون ألم يروا كم أهلكنا قبلهم من القرون أنهم إليهم لا يرجعون وإن كل لما جميع لدينا محضرون وآية لهم الأرض الميتة أحييناها وأخرجنا منها حبا فمنه يأكلون وجعلنا فيها جنات من نخيل وأعناب وفجرنا فيها من العيون ليأكلوا من ثمره وما عملته أيديهم أفلا يشكرون سبحان الذي خلق الأزواج كلها مما تنبت الأرض ومن أنفسهم ومما لا يعلمون وآية لهم الليل نسلخ منه النهار فإذا هم مظلمون والشمس تجري تجري لمستقر لها ذلك تقدير العزيز العليم والقمر قدرناه منازل حتى عاد كالعرجون القديم لا الشمس ينبغي لها أن تدرك القمر ولا الليل سابق النهار وكل في فلك يسبحون وآية لهم أنا حملنا ذريتهم في الفلك المشحون وخلقنا لهم من مثله ما يركبون وإن نشأ نغرقهم فلا صريخ لهم ولا هم ينقذون إلا رحمة منا ومتاعا إلى حين وإذا قيل لهم اتقوا ما بين أيديكم وما خلفكم لعلكم ترحمون وما تأتيهم من آية من آيات ربهم إلا كانوا عنها معرضين وإذا قيل لهم أنفقوا مما رزقكم الله قال الذين كفروا للذين آمنوا أنطعم من لو يشاء الله أطعمه إن أنتم إلا في ضلال مبين ويقولون متى هذا الوعد إن كنتم صادقين ما ينظرون إلا صيحة واحدة تأخذهم وهم يخصمون فلا يستطيعون توصية ولا إلى أهلهم يرجعون ونفخ في الصور فإذا هم من الأجداث إلى ربهم ينسلون قالوا يا ويلنا من بعثنا من مرقدنا هذا ما وعد الرحمن وصدق المرسلون إن كانت إلا صيحة واحدة فإذا هم جميع لدينا محضرون فاليوم لا تظلم نفس شيئا ولا تجزون إلا ما كنتم تعملون إن أصحاب الجنة اليوم في شغل فاكهون هم وأزواجهم في ظلال على الأرائك متكئون لهم فيها فاكهة ولهم ما يدعون سلام قولا من رب رحيم وامتازوا اليوم أيها المجرمون ألم أعد إليكم يا بني آدم أن لا تعبدوا الشيطان إنه لكم عدو مبين وأن اعبدوني هذا صراط مستقيم ولقد أضل منكم جبلا كثيرا أفلم تكونوا تعقلون هذه جهنم التي كنتم توعدون اصلوها اليوم بما كنتم تكفرون اليوم نختم على أفواههم وتكلمنا أيديهم وتشهد أرجلهم بما كانوا يكسبون ولو نشاء لطمسنا على أعينهم فاستبقوا الصراط فأنى يبصرون ولو نشاء لمسخناهم على مكانتهم فما استطاعوا مضيا ولا يرجعون ومن نعمره ننكسه في الخلق أفلا يعقلون وما علمناه الشعر وما ينبغي له إن هو إلا ذكر وقرآن مبين لينذر من كان حيا ويحيى حق القول على الكافرين أولم يروا أنا خلقنا لهم مما عملت أيدينا أنعاما فهم لا مالكون وذللناها لهم فمنها ركوبهم ومنها يأكلون ولهم فيها منافع ومشارب أفلا يشكرون واتخذوا من دون الله آلهة لعلهم ينصرون لا يستطيعون نصرهم وهم لهم جند محضرون فلا يحزنك قولهم إنا نعلم ما يسرون وما يعلنون أولم يرى الإنسان أنا خلقناه من نطفة فإذا هو خصيم مبين وضرب لنا مثلا ونسي خلقه قال من يحيي العظام وهي رميم قل يحييها الذي أنشأها أول مرة وهو بكل خلق عليم الذي جعل لكم من الشجر الأخضر نارا فإذا أنتم منه توقدون أوليس الذي خلق السماوات والأرض بقادر على أن يخلق مثلهم بلى وهو الخلاق العليم إنما أمره إذا أراد شيئا أن يقول له كن فيكون فسبحان الذي بيده ملكوت كل شيء وإليه ترجعون بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اللهم يا ذا المن ولا يمن عليه
آمين.
يا ذا الجلال والإكرام
آمين.
يا ذا الطول والإنعام
آمين.
لا إله إلا أنت ظهر اللاجئين
آمين.
وجار المستجيرين
آمين.
وأمان الخائفين
آمين.
اللهم إن كنت كتبتنا عندك في أم الكتاب أشقياء أو محروم
آمين.
أو مطرودين
آمين.
أو مقترا علينا في الرزق فامحوا اللهم بفضلك شقاوتنا وحرماننا
آمين.
وطردنا
آمين.
واقتتار رزقنا
آمين.
واثبتنا عندك في أم الكتاب سعداء مرزوقين
آمين.
موفقا للخيرات
آمين.
فإنك قلت وقولك الحق في كتابك المنزل
آمين.
على لسان نبيك المرسل
آمين.
يمحو الله ما يشاء ويثبت
آمين.
وعنده أم الكتاب
آمين.
إلهنا بالتجلي الأعظم في ليلة النصف من شهر شعبان
آمين.
المكرم
آمين
التي يفرق فيها كل أمر حكيم ويبرم
آمين.
أن تكشف عنا من البلاء والبلواء ما نعلم وما لا نعلم
آمين.
وأنت به أعلم
آمين.
إنك أنت الأعز الأكرم
آمين.
وصلى الله تعالى على سيدنا وحبيبنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله. Inshallah, we still have some time. Then let's do some dhikr, inshallah. Nothing is better than a dhikr in the Bayt Allah, inshallah. Astaghfirullah, 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 astaghfirullah. استغفر الله 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 استغفر الله
لا اله الا هو الحي القيوم اتوب اليه شهد الله أنه لا إله إلا هو والملائكة وأولو العلم قائما بالقسط لا إله إلا هو العزيز الحكيم لا إله إلا الله
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 سيدنا وحبيبنا محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليك وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا حبيبي يا رسول الله إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما
اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم
اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعليه وصحبه وسلم. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعليه وصحبه وسلم. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعليه وصحبه وسلم. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وآله 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 وصحبه وسلم. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.
وسلم تسليما كثيرا. الدعاء إن شاء الله. اللهم إني داع فأمنوا. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. نسألك يا الله يا أرحم الراحمين، يا رب العالمين، يا أول الأولين، يا آخر الآخرين، يا ذا القوة المتين، يا راحم الفقراء والضعفاء والمساكين، ارحم ضعفنا وتول أمرنا واحسن خلاصنا وبلغنا مما يرضيك آمالنا. اللهم تب علينا واهدنا وعافنا واعف عنا. آمين. وتقبلنا في الصالحين. آمين. واجعلنا من أوليائك المقربين. آمين. واغفر لنا وارحمنا، أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. آمين. اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات. آمين. والمؤمنين والمؤمنات. آمين. الأحياء منهم والأموات. آمين. إنك يا مولانا سميع قريب مجيب الدعوات. آمين. اللهم ارحمنا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم أجرنا من النار. آمين. اللهم أجرنا من النار. آمين. اللهم أجرنا من النار. آمين. وأدخلنا الجنة مع الأبرار. آمين. يا عزيز يا غفار. آمين. اللهم اشف مرضانا. اللهم اشف مرضانا. آمين. اللهم اشفنا ظاهرا وباطنا يا شافي الأمراض يا داوي الأسقام اشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين أجمعين وارحم موتانا وموتى المسلمين أجمعين اللهم بارك لنا في النصف من شعبان وفيما بقي من شعبان وبلغنا رمضان لا فاقدين ولا مفقودين ولا محرومين يا أرحم الراحمين تقبل منا الصلاة والصيام والقيام واحشرنا في زمرة خير الأنام سيدنا وحبيبنا محمد عليه الصلاة والسلام اللهم بارك لنا في مجتمعنا هذا اللهم بارك لنا في مسجدنا هذا ووفقنا فيه لما تحب وترضى اللهم وفقنا فيه لما تحب وترضى اللهم اجمع شمل المسلمين ووحد كلمتهم على الحق والدين اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين وأذل الشرك والمشركين اللهم انصر من نصر الدين واخذل من خذل المسلمين واجعلنا آمنين مطمئنين في كل مكان وزمان يا رب العالمين اللهم كل إخواننا في فلسطين وفي الشام وفي العراق وفي اليمن وفي أفغانستان وباكستان والهند وكشمير وبرما وفي كل مكان يا رب العالمين وفي الصين يا رب العالمين اللهم كل إخواننا في الصين يا رب العالمين اللهم اجمع شمل المسلمين ووحد كلمتهم على الحق والدين يا أرحم الراحمين يا رب العالمين اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا وحبيبنا محمد. Please make special dua for one scholar. He passed away in Morocco yesterday. He's from Mauritania, Sheikh Salk. Let's make dua and recite Fatiha for him, inshallah. اللهم ارحمه يا أرحم الراحمين
آمين.
اللهم اغفر له يا رب العالمين
آمين.
اللهم ارزقنا وإياه العلا من الجنة يا رب العالمين
يا رب.
مع النبيين والصديقين والشهداء
آمين.
والصالحين
آمين.
اللهم نور قبره واجعل قبره نورا وضياء عليه يا رب العالمين
آمين يا رب.
آمين, آمين. الفاتحة هنا.
Alright. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما تعلمنا وزدنا من فضلك علما اللهم لا سهل إلا ما جعلته سهلا وأنت تجعل الحزن إذا شئت سهلا. Dear brothers and sisters, dear members of the community, I feel blessed tonight that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala facilitated for all of us to gather on this blessed night. Tonight is the night of the 15th of Sha'ban. And what I'd like to do tonight is only to focus on one thing, which is mentioned in the hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. First, I think we'll give some information about, general information that we're all familiar with, but it's good to remind ourselves of these information again. I thought we could focus on understanding the hadith that came from our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so that we can apply it if we can, and if not, it'll help us for next year, inshallah. So, as you know, we are now in the blessed season, the season of Rajab, Sha'ban, and Ramadan. Sha'ban is called the month of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In these months, the Qibla was changed from facing Jerusalem to facing Mecca. It took place about approximately 2 months prior to mid-Ramadan. So most likely it took place in Rajab. But there are some statements that it could also have taken place in Shaban. Less likely, but these positions are there. Also, it was in the month of Shaban that most likely the verse "Inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna 'ala an-nabi" was revealed. Anyway. So the month of Shaban is famous for we are told that our records are presented before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala periodically. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is aware of what we do all the time. He looks at our hearts all the time. He scans our heart. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنْظُرُ إِلَى صُوَرِكُمْ وَلَا إِلَى أَعْمَالِكُمْ وَلَكِنْ يَنْظُرُ إِلَى قُلُوبِكُمْ. Allah does not look at your forms or your power or your money or your fame or your material wealth, but he scans your heart. So we know that. But we're also told that periodically our records, our deeds are presented before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wouldn't you want your records to be clean when they're presented before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of the universe? So we are told that our records are presented before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the month of Shaban, as we will see in the hadith. But specifically, if we were talking about the middle Shaban, the 15th of Shaban, Nusuf Shaban, we have a hadith from Ahmad and At-Tabarani that Allah, exalted as He, descends to the nearest heaven in the middle night of Shaban, and His forgiveness is greater than the number of hairs on the sheep in the tribe of Kalb. I.e., says in the hadith, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَنْزِلُ فِي لَيْلَةِ نُصْفِ مِنْ شَعْبَانِ فَيَغْفِرُ لِأَكْثَرَ مِنْ شَعْرِ بَنِي كَلْبِ. So imagine sheep, and sheep are full of hair. Can you, these hair, are they countable or uncountable? The set of hair is an uncountable set. It's millions and millions and of hair. And it says in the hadith that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives. His forgiveness is greater than the number of hairs on the sheep in the tribe of Kalb. Every forgiveness has conditions attached to it. So, also in the narrations by Imam Bayhaqi, it says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, إِذَا كَانَ لَيْلَةُ النُّصْفِ مِنْ شَعْبَانِ اطَّلَعَ اللَّهُ إِلَى خَلْقِهِ. Actually, the narration started earlier. Narration started with Sayyid Aisha narrating that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam bata indaha. It was her turn. And alayhi salatu wa sallam stayed with her the night. فَقَامَ مِنَ اللَّيْلِ يُصَلِّي. So he started praying in the night. Then as Sayyidah Aisha says, فَسَجَدَ فَأَطَالَ السُّجُودِ. He made sujood, and he stayed in sujood for so long. Sayyidah Aisha got scared. She got worried that he passed away, because he made sujood for such a long time. So she came near to him. فَسَمِعَتْهُ يَقُولُ أَعُوذُ بِعَفْوِكَ مِنْ عُقُوبَتِكَ. While he was in prostration. أَعُوذُ بِعَفْوِكَ مِنْ عُقُوبَتِكَ وَبِرِضَاكَ مِنْ سَخَطِكَ وَبِكَ مِنْكَ لَا أُحْصِي ثَنَاءً عَلَيْكَ أَنْتَ كَمَا أَثْنَيْتَ عَلَى نَفْسِكَ. So when he finished his prayer, he told the Sayyid Aisha, "Atadrina ma hazihi al-layla? Do you know what this night is about?" قالت, "Allahu wa rasuluhu a'lam." Usually when the Prophet ﷺ asks something, even if you know what it is, you might think things have changed. He say, and it happened also in the time of Hajj many times when he asked them, "What day is this?" They know it's Eid al-Adha. They said, "Has the day changed?" And then he kept asking them questions until they thought that things have changed and now he's going to name them differently or give them different names. She said, "Allahu wa rasuluhu a'lam." He told her, "This is the night of the Mid-Sha'ban." And then Imam Bayhaqi narrated another hadith where it says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the middle of Sha'ban, ittala Allahu ala khalqi, that Allah looks extensively at the hearts, at his servants. فَيَغْفِرُ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ, he forgives the believers. Aywa. وَيَرْحَمُ الْمُسْتَرْحَمِينَ, and he gives his mercy to those that seek mercy. وَيُمْلِي لِلْكَافِرِينَ, and postpones and delays those who are kafirs. I.e. they're not eligible to receive this rahmah or this maghfirah. وَيَدَعُ أَهْلَ الْحِقْدِ لِحِقْدِهِمْ حَتَّى يَدَعُوهَ, and then also doesn't pay attention to those who harbors animosity in their hearts toward others until they leave their animosity. I have a question for you, inshallah, when we get to, we'll pick one hadith and focus on it, and let's try to understand it together and see the beauty in it. The other hadith is from Ibn Majah and Ibn Hibban. It's a hadith of Mu'az ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu, who relates the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying that Allah looks at his creation during the middle night of Sha'ban. Allah looks at his creation all the time. But here the word ittala'a yattali'u, usually this word in modern usage, it's used to indicate extensive look. It's, you say, after we've extensively looked at this matter, this is our verdict. Like if you're in a business setting or in a court setting or in a legal setting, and a lawyer or a judge is looking extensively at your case, and then he says, after looking extensively at your case, this is the judgment. This is how we're going to rule. Or this is the best solution for you. Or your accountant when you're doing your taxes. He says, after looking at your case, this is the best way to avoid paying taxes. So that's the word that is used. It's not just he looks, but look, it's an emphatic form. There's an emphasis that your heart is scanned completely. No corner of the heart is and can escape. Anything you have in the heart is revealed. And it's an extensive look to the point that everything is searched and everything is looked at. During the middle night of Sha'ban, and forgive them all. So if you're eligible, see, the hadith is saying that your heart is going to be presented before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Sha'ban, our records are presented, but in the Nusuf of Sha'ban, our heart is presented. I.e., you're saying, "Oh Allah, look at my heart." What does that mean? Would you show someone your house before cleaning the house? Would you show someone, would you invite people and your house is messy? Like, my house is messy, but anyone else? Would you invite anyone before? No. So this requires that some preparation is done. So when we read this hadith, it's not a hadith that we should read on the Nusuf of Sha'ban. It's a hadith we should have read a month earlier or 2 months earlier. And it's a hadith that we read now for next year. It's a hadith that we read for every night because no one knows when we're going to disappear and leave this world. So, and forgive them all, except an idolater, except a mushrik, and one who harbors rancor, one who has hatred in their heart. Now you might think, what's common between these two? A mushrik and someone who has hatred? Why were the two were mentioned in one hadith? Yeah, can you give us some thought? We'll come back to this point. That's an important point. Because it'll help us understanding the dimensions of this hadith. The other hadith is a hadith from Musnad Ahmad. They all revolve around the same matter. And it's a hadith of Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, radiallahu anhuma, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is reported to have said that Allah, majestic is He, looks at His creation on the middle night of Sha'ban and forgives all of His slaves, save an idolater and a murderer. A murderer is someone who has hatred toward one person and He says, that's it. I'm going to accelerate the meeting between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and kills him. So these are hadiths that we read. Imam An-Nasa'i in his Sunan narrated on the authority of Usama ibn Zayd radiallahu anhu, anhuma. And Usama he was a young man, beloved to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Hibbu Rasulillah, it's called. Usama asked the Prophet a question. He said, Ya Rasulullah, I see you fasting in Ramadan, in Sha'ban, more than any other month. And in other narrations, it is said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to fast in Sha'ban until we think that he'd never break his fast. And he used to break his fast in Sha'ban until we think that he'd never fast. And sometimes the Prophet ﷺ would fast most of Sha'ban, except a few days. So the Prophet ﷺ gave him two reasons as to why. He said, why would you fast this month more than any other month? Is there something special about this month? He said, ذَلِكَ شَهْرٌ يَغْفُلُ النَّاسُ عَنْهُ. That's the first reason. He said, this is a month that most people don't pay attention to. People pay attention to Rajab. It's one of the sacred months. And then they get busy preparing for Ramadan. And it just happens that sometimes Sha'ban just zip by and all of a sudden we're in Ramadan. We're preparing for Ramadan. Ramadan is coming. So he says, ذَلِكَ شَهْرٌ يَغْفُلُ النَّاسُ عَنْهُ. Or sometimes people may neglect it. Maybe they know about it, but they may neglect it. Or they may be completely unaware of Sha'ban. They're in a state of heedlessness about Sha'ban. So he said, ذَلِكَ شَهْرٌ يَغْفُلُ النَّاسُ عَنْهُ. It's a month where people don't pay attention to. Some of them are ignorant of this month. So there is this is an underlying principle here that, you know, it's easy to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala together. In Ramadan, it's easy. It's easy to do it in a mosque. It's easy to do it with people. But when people are not doing it or are heedless and you do it, that means you're alert. It means you're attentive. It means even if people don't do it, you still do it. So even if people are heedless about this month, one is still aware and alert. It's all about focus. It's all about focus. You see, most of us have unfocused mind. Our mind is unfocused all the time. So even in college, when we teach students, sometimes we our audience is the unfocused mind. We want to help the students focus their mind. And it's all about, at the end, it's all about paying attention. Okay, can we get this person to pay attention? Can we get myself to pay attention to Shaban? And then the next step is, how much attention should I pay? Okay, I need to pay attention, but how much attention should I pay? So if one is aware of the importance of Shaban, and even if others are heedless, but at the same time, one still engages in Shaban, alayhi salatu wasalam is talking about this. ذَلِكَ شَهْرٌ يَغْفُلُ النَّاسُ عَنْهُ. That's the first reason. Second reason, وَإِنَّ الْأَعْمَالَ تُرْفَعُ فِيهِ إِلَى اللَّهِ. And records are raised to Allah in this month. فَأُحِبُّ أَنْ يُرْفَعَ عَمَلِي وَأَنَا صَائِمٌ. I love for my records to be presented before Allah while I'm in a state of fasting, alayhi salatu wasalam says. Because fasting is also about, it has dimensions, dimensions of tawheed. So this hadith shows the importance of Sha'ban as a whole. Now, Imam al-Shafi'i is reported to have said that it has reached me from previous scholars. Imam Shafi'i was born in the year 150, died in the year 204. So he lived only for 54 years. But he's in the second century of Hijrah, and he frequented the major scholars of his time, including Imam Malik, including Imam Muhammad ibn al-Hasan al-Shaybani, the companion of Abu Hanifa, Sufyan ibn Uyayna, all the major early Muslims. He says, بلغني أن هناك خمس ليالي يستجاب فيها الدعوات. It has reached me that there are five nights where dua is likely to be answered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The night of Friday, the night of Eid al-Fitr, the night of Eid al-Adha, the night of Middle Sha'ban, Nusuf Sha'ban, and the night of the first of Rajab. And then he says that I also find it favorably to make dua in those five nights. So also his independent judgment and ijtihad, he also reached the same conclusion. However, you know, as we all know, dua has prerequisites and has conditions. Because dua is to be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are guaranteed that our dua is accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but provided that we fulfill the conditions of dua. And if we fulfill the conditions of dua, then our dua will be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the hadith it is mentioned that رُبَّ أَشْعَسَ أَغْبَرَ. Perhaps a person who is disheveled and is in distress and agony, raising his hands to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, asking him and making dua. And then Prophet says, سَأَنَّ يُسْتَجَابُ لَهُ. How could his prayer be answered while his income is haram and his food is haram and his ismu is haram? So dua has prerequisites. So one of the prerequisites of dua is to say sorry to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Before you ask somebody something, and if you have wronged this person in one way or another, well, the first thing one needs to say is sorry. Say, I apologize. I'm sorry for what I've done. In religious terms, sorry means tawbah. Oh Allah, I repent. That's what sorry means. Oh Allah, I repent to you. Oh Allah, I acknowledge my mistakes. I acknowledge my shortcomings. I acknowledge my sins. And I have made a firm intention to, I regret them, and I promise not to do them again. So that's one of the prerequisites of dua, is to declare one's tawbah. Tawbah cleans your heart. And if you, inna Allah yuhibbu at-tawabin, Allah loves those who turn back to Him. So if one fulfills the conditions of dua, then our dua is likely to be accepted. So this requires some preparation, requires a plan that we have thought about it, and I want my dua to be accepted in Nusuf Sha'ban, and I'm ready for it. I'm ready for my heart to be presented, i.e., I vacuum cleaned my heart, you know. Vacuum, rearranged the furniture, you know. Oh Allah, come and visit me anytime. I'm ready. So that's those are the hadiths that are related to the month of Sha'ban and to Nusuf Sha'ban. However, if we were to look at the hadith again, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَطَّلِعُ عَلَى الْعِبَادِ, Allah looks upon the servants, looks upon the creation, and He forgives the believers. Except two things, except two people, two kinds of people. Mushriks and those who harbor animosity toward others. Why is that? Can you help me understand the hadith? What's so special about those two people? Brother Zahir is going to help me. Just your thoughts. We can make all the mistakes here as long as we don't make them outside. Yeah. This is a safe space. It's a safe space. He said because a mushrik is one who associates partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, so what? That's the next question. So what? Yes, go ahead. Want to help?
I was going to say, so mushrik is someone who associates partners, and then one who harbors animosity is almost, almost as if they're associating themselves as a partner, as in they're showing that they have the right to be angry at someone when that's God's job, or that's between God and them, essentially.
Okay, all right. Good. Yes. Okay.
Our ego is our God, so we're still doing shirk because they're both the same, right?
Interesting. Okay. Yeah. All right. Any other thoughts, sisters? Yes.
They both don't accept Allah's decree.
Sorry.
They both don't accept Allah's decree.
Okay. Good. Yes.
You're presenting your heart.
Yes.
So it has to be
clean. Okay. So. How is that? All right. Okay. That's very good. Yes. Because you haven't. Yes. Okay. Good.
For example, someone could be oppressing you, and you're not allowed to have that animosity.
You can have hatred for the sake of Allah, but not hatred because you hate that person. Yes, that's now yourself, your nafs. But if somebody commits sin, or somebody is
Someone beats their wife in the wife page tour.
Yeah, like, yeah, in our religion, we hate the sin. As in the surah, it says, إِنَّهُ عَمَلٌ غَيْرُ صَالِحٌ عَمَلْ آلِ لُوطٍ. But if one was to hate a person, it needs to be for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They've done something that, but if your hatred is true and sincere, i.e. if they were to change their behavior, you would also change. That's sincerity is a very tricky thing. Yes, one more. Tfaddal.
Mm-hmm. And they ask for forgiveness, and you forgive them, but you still have that hatred and animosity, right? You don't forget, so you still have that hatred still, right? Your mother-in-law, your father-in-law, your in-laws, right? You know, they do things and to hurt you, but you forgive them, but you still in your heart have that hatred. It's not gone.
You see the. Think about it at the time of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Take, for example, Khalid ibn al-Walid. Sayyiduna Khalid. There is no house amongst the Muhajirin and the Ansar that Khalid ibn al-Walid did not kill a family member of that heart. He killed. Like, he was, and he never lost a war, this person. He was one of three people in history that never lost a war in his life. As soon as he became Muslim, they embraced him like a brother. And all the hatred disappears. Why? Because it wasn't hatred for the self. Can we be like that? That's difficult. That's very difficult. Yes? Yes, of course. Yeah.
So it's not as simple, right?
It's not the same. No. So being mad is a reaction. When you get mad, is a reaction. So the Sharia doesn't have rulings on feelings and emotions, have rulings on guidelines for feelings and emotions, i.e., before you get into that state and after you get into that state. So for example, if somebody dies, somebody very close to me dies, and I feel sad. That's, the Sharia allows that, right? But if it goes to extreme, Sharia puts a guideline. Like, don't wail, don't scream, don't do this. Because normal feelings that every human being can have is sanctioned by the Sharia. But the consequences of those feelings is where the Sharia puts limits on. And also, don't put yourself in a situation where, you know, I would get mad and get angry. So there are guidelines before and after. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam قال إنما الشديد من يملك نفسه عند الغضب. قال ليس الشديد بالسرعة. The strong man is not someone who can beat another man. But الشديد من يملك نفسه عند الغضب. A strong man is someone who can restrain himself or herself when they're angry, when they fall. You have to channel your anger in the proper way. Because anger reflects a pain. There's a pain somewhere, and you're manifesting that pain in the form of an anger. Or sometimes it reflects an ability to communicate. When you don't know how to communicate, you get angry and you get mad and you start throwing a tantrum and all these things. And it reflects a little bit of self-insecurities. If someone has high self-esteem, usually people who have high self-esteem know how to communicate. Communicate their thoughts, they know how to deal with people and manage people. If one has low self-esteem, which can be changed. Yeah. And everything can be worked on. We can always become better than what we are today. But let's go back to the hadith. Yes?
I was saying when you prolong anger,
Okay. It's settled in the heart now. Yeah. It becomes
concentrated.
It finds home.
Yeah, it finds a home
there. Okay.
Kind of like has envy.
So why do people have hatred? Like, why do people have, they fight with each other? It's one of four things. It's either power, or money, or fame. Yeah, exactly. There are four or five things that drives people to get mad at each other. Oh, he got it. He got the job. I didn't get it. He got the girl. I didn't get it. Huh? Right. So let's go back to the hadith. That inna Allah yattali'u 'ala al-'ibad. And he scans the heart and he looks extensively at the heart. Imam Ghazali, in the Ihya, mentions that the statement of Tawheed, La ilaha illallah, Muhammadun Rasulullah, is a statement about love. Is a statement about love. فيقول إن التلفظ بكلمتي الشهادة التزام للتوحيد وشهادة بإفراد المعبود وشرط تمام الوفاء به ألا يبقى للموحد محبوب سوى الواحد الفرد. He said, شرط تمام الوفاء به. So the conditions for fulfilling the Tawheed statement, the kalima, is that there should not remain in the heart of the one who says it anything except the one, the unique. I.e., you clean your heart, you vacuum your heart, and you say, oh Allah, there is nothing in my heart but you. But you. Why? Because المحبه لا تقبل الشريكه. See, love doesn't accept partners. It does not. You tell your wife, I love you, but I love also someone else. You'll sleep on the couch tonight. You won't sleep. You'll sleep outside or in the snow if you're in Canada. No. Love doesn't accept partners, partnership. And to say Tawheed with the tongue only, anybody can do it. Anyone can do it. But when you declare your love, when you say, La ilaha illallah, in my heart there is nothing but Allah. So you're going to be tested. The degree of love is going to be tested. And how do you get tested? So when you say, I love somebody, love always implies that there have to be sacrifices. Because you tell a person, if I can get your love, I'm willing to let go of coffee in the morning. I'm willing to let go of my car. I'm willing to let go of something. If I could only have your heart. You're willing to let go of something to get the heart of the beloved. But you say, I love you, but I'm not willing to sacrifice anything for you. Anyone can say that. So when I tell the students, what's the relationship between love and zakat? And they say, look at me like, what are you talking about? Love and zakat. Because that's it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will test you. Do you love money more or do you love Allah more? So when there is zakat, you trim your wealth a little bit, like you trim your trees in order to grow better. So you trim your wealth a little bit and then the wealth will grow in a blessed way. So your love is going to be tested by your ability to let go and be separated from other things that you love. People usually will prove their degree of love by talking about what they will sacrifice for that love. I love you more than I love X, Y, and Z. You want to get an iPhone, right? You want to get an iPhone. iPhone costs $1,000. Well, which one do you love more, the iPhone or the $1,000? I love you more than the money I have in my pocket. I'm willing to pay it, to sacrifice that money to get this iPhone. I love you more. I want to get your heart. In order to get your heart, I'm willing to sacrifice X, Y, and Z. I'm willing to sacrifice, you know, you name it. Whatever you love the most. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَن تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا مِمَّا تُحِبُّونَ. لَن تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ. You will not achieve birr until you spend of that which you love. So the word birr in Arabic has, the meaning has multiple connotations. But there are two main connotations of birr. And the same word birr is also used with parents. بِرُّ الْوَالِدَيْنِ. Birr toward the parents. لَن تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ, i.e., the two main meanings of birr is rida and rahmah. I.e., you will not achieve the rida of Allah, the pleasure of Allah, and the mercy of Allah until you spend of that which you love. بِرُّ الْوَالِدَيْنِ, the same thing. The pleasure of your parents with you, as well as they always pray for you and they have mercy on you. And mercy of the mother is indescribable. فَلَن تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا مِمَّا تُحِبُّونَ. So you get tested. So Sayyidina Umar spent, Abu Bakr spent all his money, Sayyidina Umar spent half of his money, one person spent the best horse he had, one person spent a well, he gave a well for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whenever we declare, we make a categorical statement, you know, don't ever do that. But if you do that, you're going to be tested. You're going to be, yes?
Ramadan is an example of that, in that our love for Allah, we're sacrificing our food that we love, and we're sacrificing our relations in the daytime.
Mm-hmm.
So we're sacrificing our love. So that's one of the ways, it's a good thing.
Yeah, so.
Especially when it's halal stuff, right?
Yeah. So when you talk about love, you're also talking about that which you're willing to sacrifice. So now, if we get back to the hadith, Allah will scan the heart. What's in your heart? Is it the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as you claim? Or is it something else? What's the common between somebody who has hatred and somebody who is a mushrik? In their heart, there is no Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The heart is not clean at all. And the mushrik, his heart is still decorated with everything but Allah. So how could he receive the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And the other person is full of hatred. Hatred and love is basically the same feelings, emotions, just the switch is turned the other way around. So instead of directing hatred toward things that are the Sharia looks down upon, he's turning his hatred and his feelings and emotions towards something that he should not be hating. What does this mean? It means, you know, when we want to change, and in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. Allah does not change the situation of people until they change what's in their hearts. But my heart is not under my control. My heart is under the control of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So how could I change my heart? Because قُلُوبُ الْعِبَادِ بَيْنَ أَصْبُعَيْنِ مِنْ أَصَابِعِ الرَّحْمَنِ يُقَلِّبُهُمَا كَيْفَ يَشَاءَ. The qalb is called qalb because it's always changing. You always change. It's like when somebody tells you, I love you. You're saying, oh, she loves me for until the end of life. No, she's saying, I love you at this moment. But 5 minutes later, I may hate you. And there is no contradiction between the two. Because it means I love how you make me feel at this moment. And when she hates you, She also hates how you make her feel at this moment. No contradiction. But we also know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, من أتاني يمشي أتيته هروى. So there is a step that we can take on our own. Even a disbeliever can take this step. Because the ayah in the Quran says, وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا. Those who struggle and strive in our path, we shall guide them to our path. And the ulama said, this applies to both Muslims and non-Muslims. And the minimum one can is to make a decision in the heart that I'm willing to accept the truth no matter where it comes from. I.e., we always say, let's say we're there's a drought in California, and we say, where's water? I need water, I need water, I need water. And let's say it starts raining outside. And if you say, I want water, I want water, I want water, all you have to do is that grab your bucket and go outside and pour it under the rain, and you get water. So you have to make a step. Once you make a step, Allah will make 10 steps toward you, or 100 steps, or 1,000 steps. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it a condition that we have to show a willingness to accept the truth. And this doesn't only apply to non-Muslims. Apply to Muslims, because when we are Muslims, we become stubborn. We think we're now, you know, on cloud 9 or in paradise. No, it's always like that. Sometimes I accept the truth up to a certain point. Because what is our commitment? As Muslims, what are we are committed to the most? What do you think? What are we committed to the most? We are committed to the truth. This commitment we call Iman, because Allah is the truth, capital T. That's our commitment. Everybody has commitment, whether one is an atheist, or a Christian, or a Jew, or a Muslim. People have commitment. The atheists have commitment toward materialism. They're committed to that. Other people have commitment towards something. In your job, you must have commitments. What is it you're committed to the most? As Muslims, we're committed to the truth.
To the truth. To the truth.
Yeah, the truth, finding it, and then following it. Finding it is called Iman. That's the first thing. But to remain on Iman and not to be distracted and not our heart, you know, getting corrupted, that's not an easy task. It takes a lot of effort. Yeah, that's the truth. Our commitment is to al-haqq. Al-haqq. Bikulli masadiqihi. Because the Sirat al-Mustaqim is just one of the element of haqq. Right? It's like you have a set and you have elements in the set. So these are examples of al-haqq. And the opposite of haqq is batil, falsehood. And sometimes we use metaphor, we say when the haqq comes, kicks out the falsehood and expels it out the door. It's like the falsehood is an entity and the truth comes and kicks it out. That's a metaphor to make it understandable. So, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. And this works both ways, positively and negatively. So if you change your heart, what's in your heart in a negative way, Allah leaves you alone. But if you make a decision in a positive direction, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will also support you and present you with another option. Then you have to make another decision. Because you may say, I'm committed to the truth up to a certain point, but beyond that point, I don't know. Maybe I will stay committed, maybe not. You know, the ulama asked a question, can a person deceive himself? People can deceive themselves. All right, so let's, we don't want to take much of your time.
Well, one last thing on the shirk side.
Yeah.
One has to be, could you sort of deconstruct that? Because like, it was like,
you see, when the examples we heard before,
yeah,
they're all symptoms. What is the root cause? The root cause is that it's in here. That's where the root cause is. Yes. Associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is a manifestation of what's in the heart. But when you say la ilaha illallah, it means la ilaha, la ilaha. I looked into my heart and I've cleaned it from anything worthy of being adored or worshipped except you. That's a minor shirk. That's Sharia.
But then if you have that, is your du'a, are you considered a mushrik?
No, it's a minor shirk. Okay. It's something you have to work on. And we all fall into that. When I give donation to the mosque, I give donations only if the media is there and they're taking a picture of me. That's Ria. A show off. I'm showing off. Because these things are psychological state. The Prophet ﷺ was asked about those who go on military expeditions, hamiyatan, just to defend the tribe, or shaja'atan. They get intoxicated when people call them courageous. He said, and then he was asked, which of those are fi sabilillah? He said, من قاتل لتكون كلمة الله هي العليا فهو في سبيل الله. If you go on a military expedition to raise the word of Allah, that's for the sake of Allah. What does this mean? It means that's an intellectual decision. The other three, they're making an emotional decision. It's a psychological state that drove them to kick somebody just to show that he's courageous, or to avenge someone because they've insulted the honor of the tribe or the honor of the family or my honor. Right? So those are ashya'un nafsaniya. There's a difference between a nafsani decision and an intellectual decision. Intellectual decision, I thought, no. I want to deliver the message. I want to convey the message. I want to raise the لِتَكُونَ كَلِمَةُ اللَّهِ يَلْعُدْ. That's an intellectual decision. That's not an emotional decision. That's different. طيب. So it says, now in the hadith it talks about those who are mushriks, those who either their heart is completely corrupted or partially corrupted, like the one who has hatred. The hatred has taken firm in the heart, and it needs to be uprooted before it is eligible for the mercy and forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But this shows that all of us could fall into this. We are not immune from hating people. So if we want our records to be presented before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to be forgiven, we have to work on lubricating that part and let it. Or at least, if you don't, maybe the one, you don't have to become a friend with them, but don't hate them. Don't hate them. For your own sake. For your own sake.
Be civilized,
polite, friendly. Yeah. You can have a business relationship with them. Assalamu alaikum. That's it. Some people, they do this with the Prophet. It's like the business relationship. Oh, Messenger of Allah, we're going to follow you. Instead of someone hugging the Prophet, he says, I'm willing to do anything for you. That's love. What is it you're willing to sacrifice? For the sake of whom you love. But then the hadith talks about istighfar and maghfira. And Raghib al-Asfahani, in his dictionary on the Quran, he said the word maghfira used to be a shield that the soldiers used to wear around the neck. And so this is like a metal shield, and it protects the neck and the body from arrows that are being shot at you, or from bullets. So imagine the sins are like bullets. They're trying to harm you and kill you, and this maghfira, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cover you with, to protect you from sins and forgive all your sins. The words of the hadith are really interesting. Each word has a meaning and has connotations. And understanding these words إن شاء الله will, I hope will help us appreciate the hadith and how to benefit from this hadith so that إن شاء الله at least next year we can be prepared and this year it's never too late. If there is any question or any comment or observation or something you wish to add, hello, Salam. We're here to learn.
Just a question about Khalid bin Walid. You said, you know, he's, we all know he's the only person who was not defeated in any part. You said there are three. Who are the other two?
Alexander the Great, and like they're historical figures. Historical figures, yeah. Yeah. One time the Prophet ﷺ was sleeping under a tree and a Bedouin came and he snatched the sword of the Prophet ﷺ and then he woke him up. He said, Ya Muhammad, man yamna'uka minni? He says, Oh Muhammad, who can protect you now from me? Your sword is in my hand. I can kill you anyone. And the Prophet ﷺ says, Allah. And the sword fell from his hand. The Prophet took the sword and told them, Man yamna'uka minni? Who can protect you from me now? He says, Ya Muhammad, kun khayra akhiz. Be the best of those who are in control. He said, Go. So then the person became Muslim. And so this shows that Prophet ﷺ was not, you know, because he could have killed him. Yeah? If it was like a personal feeling, you were about to kill me, I'm going to kill you. It's not like that. Alayhi salatu wasalam wants people to, because like, in our view, Iman is life. Iman is life. Ilm is life. Iman leads to eternal life in the hereafter. We want people to have eternal life and to have guidance. What's the benefit of people dying and going to hellfire? That's not what the Prophet ﷺ is about. مَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ يعني الرَّحْمَةُ مَتَى تَكُونُ رَحْمَةُ رَحْمَةً When does mercy can be called a mercy? A mercy is called a mercy if it is شاملة and if it is... You see, I say, you need $10,000. You come to me. You need to have an operation for your son or whatever. And I give you the $10,000 a year from now. Is this mercy? It's not mercy because you didn't get it at the time you needed it. Or you ask for $10,000, I give you a penny. Is this mercy? No. The mercy has to be enough to cover your needs at the right time, at the right moment, in the right place. That's what's mercy. And alayhi salatu wasalam was sent to humanity at the right time, at the right moment. Because when he was sent to humanity, imagine an earthquake hitting California. When you have an earthquake, everything will be upside down, everything will be in, you know. So the same thing happened to humanity. An earthquake hit humanity, but not a physical earthquake. It's a moral earthquake. It's a spiritual earthquake that have changed values. Values became upside down. The Arabs, they had good values and good morals, but they've taken them to extremes. So they were courageous, but they take courage to extreme. They had honor, they took honor to extreme. Their honor was if they get a baby girl as a baby daughter, they would consider this as dishonor. Huh? So they would bury the girls alive. Because they thought this is against our honor. So they took honor to extreme. Alayhi salatu wasalam was sent to put everything back in the right place. So after an earthquake, a huge effort has to be put to reconstruct everything and put everything in the right place. He put everything in the right place in terms of rulings, in terms of akhlaq, in terms of values, in terms of relationships, in terms of what's important, priorities, what's important, what's not important, and the degrees of priorities. So we as Muslims, we think, we're proud, we think that we have, we know our priorities. We know our priorities. Alayhi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam explained to us our priorities. And we wish everyone would know these same priorities, because it will help them. These priorities, they don't also help us in religion, but they also help, they can help us also in our work as professionals. Now,
What should our attitude be towards like groups of people? So we talked about like harboring animosity for an individual. What about like groups? You know, it could be anyone. It could be another nation. It could be a particular association. And then well, attitude as well as like how we talk about them, like let's say on WhatsApp.
Yeah, I mean, every question has a history behind it. And I'm not sure what you have in mind. But usually when one talk about a group, they're talking about an idea or some values that this group holds. Now, on the other hand, when you meet a person that belongs to that group, you'll find that now you're meeting a person. Every person is different from another person. And you want to verify, you know, who is this person? What does he believe in? Is he open-minded? Is he not open-minded? It's a completely different game. So talking about groups in general and then meeting people face-to-face, it's a... Anything we measure according to the guidance of the Sharia. So what do they promote? And then we can measure these values according to the values that the standards we know. We have a high standards. And nothing in life is going to be, you know, in this world we don't have hellfire on earth, we don't have paradise on earth. It's going to be the two. There are always pros and cons. But the cons may be more than the pros. And because of that, we're against the cons. We're not against the pro. So that's the general answer. You know, if there's a specific situation, then maybe we can talk about it. Any other comment or sisters? طيب إن شاء الله جزاكم الله خيرا. I think there is a dua by. I saw a dua by Sayyidina Abu Bakr, but it wasn't related to him. I thought it was related to Shaban, but it seems to be related to something else. If it was related, it would be nice to recite it, inshallah. Maybe another time. طيب. اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات إنك يا مولانا سميع قريب مجيب الدعوات اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد اللهم اجعل جمعنا هذا جمعا مرحوما واجعل تفرقنا من بعده تفرقا مباركا محفوظا ولا تجعل فينا ولا معنا ولا منا شقيا ولا محروما يا أرحم الراحمين هبنا جميعا لسعة رحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم تولنا وتولى إخواننا يا الله في كل مكان يا رب العالمين اللهم طهر قلوبنا من الشرك والنفاق يا الله يا كريم اللهم اغفر لنا إذا عرضت قلوبنا عليك يا الله يا كريم اللهم إنا نسألك المغفرة يا الله يا كريم اللهم إنا نسألك الرحمة يا الله يا كريم اللهم ارحمنا برحمتك الواسعة يا الله يا كريم آمين 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 والحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا